everyone. Welcome to class today with the Children's Museum of the Arts. My name is Emma. I am going to be your teacher for these classes. It is nice to meet you. What is your name? Nice to meet you. So before we begin, we are going to, I have a very quick question to ask everyone. And that is, if you could paint your room any crazy color or pattern or design, what would you choose? I'll say my answer first, and then I'll pause and wait to hear your answer. I would probably go for a rainbow of colors kind of combined together all over my room. So I have all of the bright colors because I want to go into a room that makes me feel happy, and all of the colors would make me feel happy. What about you? Amazing. So we are going to continue with that imaginative thought and creativity throughout the class today. So make sure that the imagination is in the brain. If it's not in the brain, let's put it in there. Okay, I can feel mine. Can you feel yours? Great. Okay, before we begin, I'm gonna go over a brief structure of the class, as well as the materials that we are going to be needing. Okay, the structure is that we're going to look at a piece of artwork first. We're going to talk about what we see in the art, and then we're going to create our own masterpiece based off of our own imagination that we put into our brains, or if they were already there, as well as our interpretation of the works of art. So what we see, what we observe, maybe what we feel when we look at that piece of art. We're going to be thinking about incorporating all of that into our own masterpiece. Sound good? Amazing. Okay. I'm going to go over the materials that we're going to need for today. I'm going to give enough time to pause for you to collect any materials that you might have around your house or that you think you would definitely want to use in the class today before we get into everything. So the first thing we're going to need is absolutely a piece of paper. I know mine is kind of big. Yours can be smaller than mine. Yours can be bigger than mine. It is all A-okay. I am using watercolor paper. So it's strong and sturdy and pretty thick. I'm gonna show you. It's pretty thick paper. And I'm using that because we're going to be using paint today. Now, if you do not have watercolor paper, do not worry about it. You can use any type of paper, cardstock, construction paper. You can use cardboard as your base. Cut up an old box if you have one, a shoebox, or a shopping box that you may have. That would be a perfect base if you do not have paper. The next material that we are going to use for today is something to put our paints on. I have something called palette paper, but if you do not have palette paper, I find that parchment paper or baking paper works beautifully as a hack for palette paper because it's waxy, so your paint doesn't stick or dry onto your paper. It's able to pick it up very nicely, especially a little sneak peek of some of the materials that we're going to need. Now, if you don't even have parchment paper or palette paper, a paper plate, plastic plate, or even an extra piece of paper works perfectly as palette paper. Okay, because I've been talking about paints a lot, we are going to be needing paints. I am going to be using acrylic paint. that come out in tubes. I'm going to show you my white paint. Acrylic paint, again, is what I'm using. If you have tempera paint, if you have watercolor, that is perfect. Any types of paints that you have in your home, get those out. Let's use those for today. Now, I'm going to show you mine. I have the rainbow of colors. One of my colors is flying off the shelf. And I have the rainbow of colors, but you see here that I don't have purple. And I don't have different shades of green. Now, that's because we're going to be making our own, because all we really need with paint colors are red, yellow, and blue. The primary colors. That's all we really need to mix up any other colors that we would want to use on our painting. If you have black and white, those are amazing as well. But if you don't have those colors, we don't need those. We're going to work with what we have. Okay. Now, the next materials that we are going to need before we get into some of the unconventional materials that I'll talk about is, forgive my very dirty, it's seen a lot, art, water mug, bowl, cup, whatever you have that you want to use. This is my jar that I'm using with some water already in it to prepare. I'm also going to have paper towels handy, or tissues or cloth, whatever you want to use to clean your brushes. We're going to also use this as one of our unconventional materials of painting, which I'll talk about in a little bit. Okay. The next materials are going to fall under the unconventional part. And those are going to be materials that we're going to experiment with. So besides creating and using our imagination in an array of colors, we're going to get kind of wild, maybe crazy, and use a variety of materials. So I have, which hopefully some of us have as well, I have these extra toilet paper rolls, and I have a paper towel roll as well. We're going to, now I have three in my hand. That does not mean that you have to have three in your hand. You can have one, you can have none, or you can have way more than three. I'm going to explain what we're going to be using with these when we get to our painting portion of the class. But to go with these, I'm gonna put some of these down, we are going to need some scissors, because we are going to be cutting this paper towel or toilet paper roll up to use as a stamp, or we could call it our paint brush. Okay. So the next unconventional material is going, or are going to be, some plastic cutlery. You can use regular cutlery, you just have to get an adult's permission. and even if you're using it with some paints, they clean really well. So I'm using a fork and a spoon. I couldn't find my knife. But if you have a knife that you could find, a plastic knife, go get that out. Okay. The next is an old card, an old plastic card. Mine's kind of bendable a little bit. Is we are going to be using these, again, as a painting tool. Now I say old because it might get a little bit messy. So again, a parent permission is very necessary. The next supply is some tinfoil. I'm going to explain why we might want to use these in a little bit, so don't you worry. Now, if you don't have tinfoil, do you need to use it? No, you don't have it. That's okay, right? You can use whatever materials you feel would be fun to experiment with. Now, I said I would bring out the paper towels again. We're going to need these as a cleaning tool, but also a painting tool as well, if you would like. Okay, Now, the last tools I have are might be familiar is I have a variety of brushes just in case you don't have any type of kitchen tool that you would want to use to experiment with. If you want to bring out those brushes, that is beautiful as well. All right. I'm going to allow you guys to take a pause on the video to gather your materials and shop around in your kitchen with an adult to look at what you might want to use. As you can see, the variety of materials that I have are very different than what we would consider our regular materials, because we're going to really see what marks all of these different tools can really create. And we're going to, it's going to be fun, it's going to get very silly, and very full of experimentation. So again, I'm going to allow you guys to take a pause to gather those materials. After we gather the materials, we are going to come right back and look at a famous piece of art. All right, see you in a little bit. All right, hopefully we have all gathered our supplies. If we are still gathering throughout the class, that is A-okay. As long as we have a few near us, especially when we get into the art portion. So now is the second portion of the class, which is our look section, where we are going to be looking at this artwork on the screen by Louise Fishman, who was an abstract expressionist artist. Now, she painted with, just like we're going to be painting today, with many different types of materials. In the art world, it can be called unconventional materials or found materials, because maybe like you today, we are finding them in our homes. Louise, as an artist, loved to find materials sometimes on the street, sometimes in other friends' homes, sometimes in shops that she visited or restaurants, and she would look at a material and be intrigued by that material. And she would say, how can I use this in my paintings? What type of mark would this create? And those questions that she asked herself and she asked others around her helped inform the way that she would paint and helped inform her creations. So maybe you're looking at yours and you're saying, how can I use this fork? What type of mark would this fork create? I dragged it through the paint. Or if I kind of dotted it all over my paper, what would it look like? Well, we'll find out very soon. So going off of the image that we're seeing on the screen, this is one of Louise's paintings from 2014, which is not that long ago if we think about it, and it's called Bel Canto, which the name Bel Canto is a musical term. Right, so it's a lot of things to do with music and songs and prose and lyrics. But I want to ask the question of what do you see in this work of art? Can you give us some time to look all over, look side to side, up and down, in a circle, all around, to really see the marks that Louise made on this canvas. I'll start, and I will say that I see a lot of lines, right? A lot of thick, large, chunky lines, and a lot of thin, kind of short and very long lines that go from top to bottom, side to side of the canvas. I see a variety of colors. Maybe you do as well. To me, the colors are very muted. There are no colors, maybe besides the yellow in the top middle of the canvas, that really pop, right? I don't think to correct me if I'm wrong. Please tell me if you see something differently. But I see a lot of colors that are not, they don't pop, right? They don't jar, and your eye doesn't go to them. There's a lot of blues and rust and deep kind of darker reds and yellows and grays. Now, going off of this idea of colors, do these colors make you feel happy that you're seeing on the canvas? Do they make you feel sad and angry and mad, calm? How do you feel when you look at this work of art? To me, because of these colors are very muted, right? There are no colors that are really strong to my eye, is it makes me feel kind of sad, a little bit sad, because I associate kind of calmer and darker maybe colors with sadness. If I was really happy, I think I would use, going back to the first question of class of what would we paint our rooms, I think I would use really bright colors to kind of connect to that happiness. Sometimes, or a lot of times, artists paint with their emotions in mind, right? Because colors can connect to our emotions. What would you say if I said, pick a color that you think would be labeled as happy? What color would you choose? Shout it out. I think, and our answers can be different, right? I think I would choose maybe yellow or a bright blue. To me, that would be happy. Okay. What about sad? Hopefully we're not sad right now. But what would we choose? What color would we choose if we were feeling a little bit sad? Shout it out. Okay. I think I would also choose maybe a darker blue. Maybe I would choose, and I'm going to get it up right here, my ultramarine blue. It's like a deep ocean blue. It's very calming, but also maybe it's a little bit sad. What about angry? Again, hopefully we're not angry right now. But what would we choose? I would choose red. I think red might be a classic understanding of anger or madness. Now, if I'm calm, I might choose green, because green, like a teal or an ocean green, because I think of kind of the calmness of the ocean and the water. I would choose green or blue, maybe purple also as calmness. And this is just a way to show that colors can be connected to our emotions or our feelings. So a little game we're gonna play is, what are you feeling right now? What is that emotion that you are feeling? Are you super happy, super excited, and energetic to get into class? Hopefully, I feel that. So for me, I think because of that happiness and that energy is maybe when we go into create, I would choose those bright colors. But does your answer have to be the same as mine? Hopefully we're shaking our heads saying, no way. Right? Because you are your own individual artist. And I want you to choose what you are feeling right now. Okay. The last thing we're going to talk about when looking at this Louise Fishman work of art is what we notice in her pace of her brushstrokes. Now again, she didn't just use brushes. She used her hands a lot of the time, which I know is super silly, right, when we think about finger painting, but yes, professional and famous and beautiful artists in the world also might be using their hands. It's kind of a connection that maybe we feel within our own works of art. So she thought, and a lot of artists do as well, is when they create these abstract works of art, that maybe when we look at them, maybe we don't see a dog. Maybe we don't see a building or an ice cream cone melting on the sidewalk on a super hot day, right? Maybe we just see lines and colors and feel emotion based off of what we see. That is cool as well. And these different brushstrokes, right? These different forms of pace that we might find can relate to those emotions. If you're taking your, let's just say it's a brush. If you're taking a brush and you're going super fast. I don't know, could you guys see my brush on the camera? Maybe I have to go faster, super fast. Maybe that might be because I'm so energetic. Maybe I'm mad and I'm angry and I want to get that emotion all the way out on my canvas. So I'm taking my arm, I'm lifting it off my table, and I'm going super fast. Those brush strokes are going to look very different than if I take a brush and I go slow across my page, right? These different paces, the slow-paced versus the fast-paced, are very different. So looking at this work of art, can you guys see maybe where Louise Fishman did a super fast brushstroke versus a super slow brushstroke? Can you find those? To me, I think that the big right-hand side of the image with the blue brushstroke going vertically up and down looks super fast to me, because we can't really maybe see where it ends, where it stops, because the brushstrokes were so fast, it was almost like they were invisible, right? Where you couldn't really see that brush on the canvas. And it almost creates those streaks versus those long, black, skinny lines. Those look pretty slow to me because they look more purposeful. Like they were placed for a reason, for her reason, that maybe we don't know. We probably don't know it. And that's okay, because a lot of times when we create, it's for the artist, right? It's their emotions that they place down on the canvas. So it doesn't have to have a reasoning, right? Where viewers would truly understand what they think about what, or think what the artist would think. It can be our own reasons, our own thoughts. So that's where I think maybe it's a slower pace, because I can see the line. It looks pretty purposeful. Like she thought about where she would place that brush or whatever tool she may have been using. She liked to use kind of these wire pieces as well to drag the paint. We're going to be dragging our paint on our paper as well. Okay. Are there any other comments, observations that you notice about this piece? Because we're going to help our observations of what we see going on between color, emotion, and pace of our using our tools, and allow all of those three things to help us create our own masterpiece. Definitely based off of our, what's in our brain? Our imagination, but also the way that we maybe felt or saw looking at the Louise Fishman painting. All right, everyone. The first thing that we are going to do is we are going to prepare our paper. So I have my paper placed in front of me. That's going to get me ready for creating. I have prepared my palette of the colors that I have from my tubes. So I have my reds out, I have my yellow, my blue, white, and black placed out on my paper. I like to do that because I find that it helps me have my colors already out so I can go ahead and use them intuitively, right? So this word intuition, right, is going off of what we are feeling right in the moment, what we think, right? We're not thinking too strongly, too hard.
we are just going off of saying, I'm happy, I'm gonna pick up that yellow because that's what I want to use in the moment. So that is why I like to place all of my colors out to help inform that intuition of creating. Okay, I'm going to show you the first step of using our toilet paper roll as a painting tool. So we're going to need the toilet paper roll and some scissors. Okay. So if you have these materials, what we are going to do is we are going to take our scissors and we are going to kind of go, maybe I went a little bit too high, but maybe go about a third of the way up your paper towel holder. If you need an adult to help you, don't be shy, go get that adult. Now we're going to do a few different slits. So I'm gonna do two, and I'm gonna show you that these two slits are going to create this little flap, almost like a fringe. And that's where we are going to use for stamping. So you can make as many of them as you want. Mine are pretty thick, my little flaps. They're pretty thick. If you want yours to be thinner, then you're going to cut closer together. If you want yours to be thinner, or thicker, excuse me, you are gonna cut further away. So right now I have three. I think I can make about two more cuts. So I'm gonna go one more. And then I think I'm gonna make this a little bit skinny. So I'm gonna go do one more cut. And now we have a funny little, almost like it's an, could be an octopus. with not enough legs or tentacles, but we have our funny little creature that we're going to use as a stamp. We're going to use this in addition. Maybe you have another paper towel or toilet paper holder that you're going to leave uncut because that can be a more circular or ovular stamp. All right. So hopefully we have all of our other tools. Like I'm going to definitely be using my knife, my fork, my spoon, my card holder. Maybe I have a piece of paper towel and I have some tin foil. But I'm gonna put these off to the side because the first step is to consider your emotions. What are you feeling right now? Okay, I'm feeling pretty happy because I'm creating art with you guys right now. So what I'm going to do is because I'm going to associate happiness with the brighter colors. I'm going to be taking my yellow. And what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to take my brush and I'm going to take a little bit of my yellow and put it flat on my palette. Because when I take my stamper, I'm gonna need to kind of go into this paint. So I'm gonna get a little bit more and I'm gonna kind of like press all of my tentacles down into the paint. Kind of drag a little bit more. I find sometimes, like for me, sometimes it's not working super well. So I'm gonna just paint the tentacles themselves. It's a nice little trick we can use to make sure that we have what we want. And I'm gonna go ahead and this is where I'm gonna take my finger. And I'm gonna press these little arms and legs down onto the table and my paper on the table. And I have my little, what I'm gonna call my sunburst of happiness. I'm gonna do this a few more times. I'm gonna clean my brush in my water. I'm going to go for a blue. I think I'm going to mix my blue into my yellow so I can create this lighter green. Now, this is mine, right? These are my color choices. Does this mean that it has to be your color choices? Hopefully you all shouted no. It does not mean that, right? Because are you creating my piece of art? No, right? We're creating our own work of art. So it can be whatever we want it to be because we have different materials and we have different emotions. I think I'm gonna do this about two more times with a few different colors because I'm gonna move on and experiment with my other materials. I'm getting very excited about what all of my other materials can do. And I definitely want to see them in action on my page. So my plan with this piece is to not spend too long with one material because I want to see how every material kind of can combine and work together or how they can look when they're kind of placed all over in layers. So I said I would do this one more time with my stamp, so I'm going to go ahead and do that. I'm gonna choose my next color. You can see I'm going through a variety of colors. Now, who remembers that word I said a while ago of where we're not thinking too strongly? It's kind of a silly word. Intuition. That's right, right? So I'm working intuitively. I'm saying to myself, which colors do I want to use? And as soon as the color pops up into my brain, that's what I'm choosing. Okay, so what do we think should be our next material? All right, whatever you shouted out to the screen I want you to use, I shouted out in my brain to my fork. So I'm going to see what this fork can do on my scene. What I'm going to do because I have my fork is I'm going to actually take a brush. Or you know what? I've changed my mind. I'm going to take my card first. I'm going to use these together. And with the card, I'm going to go into my red. And I'm going to pick it up on the card like this. Now, we're using the card. I have a very silly term for you guys, and it's called a squeegee. And squeegees, you might see them in the shower, right? Where if you have a glass shower door, is you take the squeegee and you kind of scrub it all the way down your door and it gets all of that excess water off. We're gonna be thinking of using the card in the same way. Where we're gonna take the card, we picked up the paint on it, and I'm going to, hopefully you guys can see it like this, I'm gonna place the card down like this, where the paint is down on the paper. And I'm going to spread this, right? I'm going to move the card down and lift it back up. And because of where I placed that paint is you're going to get the moving. We're kind of pulling the paint across so it's flat. I'm going to do it a few more times where I picked up another color and I'm going to kind of spread this all in different directions. Now, because it's plastic, right as soon as we're done with our color, we're going to just clean it off with a paper towel so that if we want to pick up another color, we can go right in, which I think I'm going to go ahead and do. I'm going to pick up yellow and white all at once, and right next to my red and my blue, I'm going to drag my yellow and white. And I'm kind of just dragging it across. I'm leaving it pretty flat. And I'm doing this because I'm kind of creating a color combination. right? Because I have some of my darker colors, like red and blue, and I'm doing some of my lighter colors, or my brighter colors, like white and yellow right next. So it creates this fancy word called contrast. Now, right now on my page, I'm gonna give it a look. And what I see is I see areas of blankness, my white. I see areas that are fully combined with color. So I kind of like this difference for me. I like this area that's solid almost because it has so much color. And I like this area that has a little bit of less color. And I'm going to continue with this thought of kind of happiness. So I'm going to be using a lot of different colors. And that's where my fork is going to come into play. And that's where I'm going to take my brush. And I'm going to take a green. My green color is kind of brighter. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to kind of take a glob of, I'm going to add a little bit of white because why not, right? We're focusing on that intuition. And I'm going to take a glob. Now, it looks like a puddle of paint right now. So with my fork, what I'm going to do is I'm going to spread. So I'm going to go in all different directions because it's going to create this almost webbed like pattern, right? Because our fork has these little four prongs on them, right? So it's going to create our own pattern, right? I think we can see it on the camera where there's own pattern of lines. And when this dries, you'll be able to take a finger and feel that texture, right? That's called the tactility of our paint and of our materials. So I'm gonna continue with this in mind. I think I'm gonna drag, again, working intuitively, I'm gonna drag a little bit of this paint kind of down, maybe into with my card, because that's what I am feeling in the moment. Maybe I'll take my spoon a little bit, kind of drag some of that paint down. All right. So by now, if you're like me and you have run out of a color, we're going to apply more of that. So I've run out of my yellow for now. So I'm going to add another little pea-sized dollop of that paint on my page. And the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take my paper towel. That's going to be my next tool that I'm choosing. And I'm going to look at the colors I have. I'm going to pick up some more yellow because I think I really want this to get a little bit brighter. And my paper towel has some of the yellow on it. If you can see, I'm squishing it with my hand because we're going to use this like a stamp. And we're going to dot up and down, up and down. I'm going to start. I'm going to show you. I'm going to go right in, and if you can see, I'm doing it on top of my other colors. So I'm not doing it on top of blank pieces of paper. I'm doing it on top of my paint that's already on the page. This is called layering, right? So we're going to layer, almost like a sandwich, right? We're building on top of what we have so far. Now, I'm a very messy artist. I like to get messy and experiment with many different colors. So I'm going to be taking my same paper towel, and I'm not worrying too much about blending of colors because I like that. I like that idea of the colors blending naturally with one another. If you're not like me and you say, I don't want these colors to blend so much, then I want you to take a clean paper towel and go right in with that clean paper towel or cloth. Alrighty. How are we doing so far? Are we having fun? Are we experimenting? Hopefully we are. Alrighty. I'm going to add this to some of the blank areas on my page. Because right now what I have is this kind of almost taking a look at my piece right now is I have a lot towards the center, right? A lot of textures and marks. And I have this kind of areas of sparseness to the sides. And I think I'm going to leave that because I like that difference. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to almost pretend like my whatever's happening in the center has started to scatter outwards. And I'm going to keep that in mind, where as I add color, if I choose to, continuing outwards, is that there's still white pieces of paper visible. Like where I'm stamping, is I'm kind of making sure to keep it pretty minimal and soft. And as you work, you might find that you created a color and the color's mixed and you don't like the way it looks. Well, the good thing about paint, especially if we're working with these quick water-based paints like acrylic or tempera, is they dry very quickly. Like I'm gonna show you right here where we added this paint, right? I'm rubbing it with my finger, but it's not coming off on my fingers. There's no blue. It's already dry. So if I wanted to, maybe I'm gonna go in and I can add and layer and cover up a little bit of that blue. I'm gonna use some black lines. Maybe you don't see a color. I don't see any purple. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to mix up with my brush a purple because I have to get purple in there. It's my favorite color. What about you guys? What are your favorite colors? Maybe they're the colors you chose for your room. So with this is I know I'm using, don't tell anyone, I'm using a brush. Because I want to add some of these lines, maybe some line work on top of some of my materialed marks. A few of these lines just because, again, that is what I felt most appropriate in the moment for me. Now, keeping this idea of abstraction in mind, right, where we don't have to create a piece where you have something or a work of art that you have something that you can label, right, that you can give a name. With abstract, right, it's things that are non-representational, pieces that maybe you say you might feel something based off of how you see it, or you might say that looks like a blob of colors. That works too. Alrighty. We have come to that time where maybe we want to think about doing our last few marks. So I'm gonna go in and pick up a few more yellow, whites and purples, add those into my scene. And I'm gonna think about what I want to be visible on my canvas or on my paper right now, right? Because when we do things, when we do last marks, those last marks, our eye usually goes to them first, which is kind of silly. So maybe you're saying, well, maybe I want to add in the letter U, because why not? So maybe you go in and you draw or you write that letter U because you want that to be seen. Or maybe you add a smiley face on your page because you're feeling happy right now and you want to use that great visualization of the smiley face to represent that emotion, in addition to the colors that you have on your scene. I'm adding in these little lines, almost like vines or tree branches, because to me, the idea of happiness and excitement always connects to nature, right? Kind of things that are maybe not man-made, right? Things that are not in our control. That's what I'm doing. Does that mean you have to do it? No. Gonna answer for all of us. Alrighty. I'm gonna add one more color. I'm gonna pick up some more yellow because that's what I started with, some yellow. So I'm gonna kind of make a whole full circle story and end with some of these yellow marks. All right. I'm gonna pause. Okay. What we are going to do is we have our layered and mark heavy composition. So I want you to do that last mark if you have not paused. And we're going to come right back up to see each other because we are going to be sharing our compositions with one another. Oh, I gave you a sneak peek. So I'm gonna count down from, let's say, five. And at the zero, we're gonna hold up our composition. So you can see mine and you can show yours to the screen. You can show it to anyone around you. From five, hopefully your hands are as dirty as mine. Four, three, two, one, zero. All right, blast off. Let's hold ours up to the camera. Or again, to everyone around you, so we can see what we've created. So right now, you can pause the video and you can talk with those around you about what you created. What I like to do is actually hold mine away, right? So kind of, I hold my arms out super long and I look at it and I say, what does this look like from a further angle? Maybe you stand up and you walk way towards the other end of your room to look at your piece. And you say, what did I create? What does it look like to me? Let's all do that with our own pieces. Let's ask ourselves that question. What does this look like to me? To mine looks like something full of a ball of energy, let's say. A ball of excitement and color that starts and roots in the center and spreads to other people, to just other days, right? It keeps spreading, almost like these little veins that connect in the center and move all the way out. That's what mine looks like. What about yours? Well, hopefully we all had fun. We all experimented with all of the different materials and marks from our found materials. Keep in mind that your materials, your found materials, you can keep adding to those. Now you have a source, you have an art material bag full of different marks and textures that you can create. Right? We've used, to recap, we've used our toilet paper rolls in stamping. We've used our paper towels to stamp. If you wanted, you could have used your tin foil to also stamp. We used our brushes for some marks. We used our card to drag our paint. Same with our fork. We kind of dragged our paint through. And when this dries, I want you to go ahead and give it a feel, right? Feel the areas that might be a little bit bumpy. I'm gonna give mine a little feel. Ooh, there's some area right here that's pretty bumpy because the paint was a little bit thicker on the canvas. So I want us to give ourselves the biggest round of applause. And I'm thanking you from the bottom of my heart for creating with me, being imaginative with me, and yourselves for today. And we are, hopefully, we will see each other for the next class for another fun and imaginative creation. Thank you guys so much and have a wonderful day. Bye everyone, see you next time.